On the screen today, there's a picture, as you'll no doubt be aware, of a Roman Caesar. And I chose his picture because if you look at his furrowed brow and the look on his face, he's obviously suffering from enormous anxiety. And perhaps from the position he's been in as Caesar, and anyone who thinks they're God would suffer just a little bit of anxiety because it's a lie. And so I put him on the screen there today just to show you that anxiety's been around for a long time, and I'm sure there's not a person here that hasn't experienced it in some way. And, you know, you get up to speak in front of people and, what is it, your palms get sweaty and your mouth goes dry. Happened to me yesterday. I really wish it were the other way around. Our palms go dry and our mouth gets moisture in it, so, but it just doesn't happen that way. And so we've all suffered and experienced anxiety in some ways. It's a perfectly healthy thing. It puts the cutting edge on your preparation. It puts a cutting edge on how you present something, and it can be very good. You know, you often hear of celebrities before they go out on stage having those anxiety moments, and but if it gets to too much, it can be very debilitating, such as panic attacks. Now that's right at the other extreme, and can develop into that, and then all of a sudden you get debilitating effects. You can have shakes, you can sweaty, just freeze on the spot, your mind goes blank, and once it gets to that stage, it becomes a real nuisance and a disorder. It's okay to have things in their right perspective, but when it becomes a disorder, that's when it really starts to be debilitating. Now, I have a bit of a unique word picture to give in demonstrating how social anxiety is generated. And I think in America they say it's America's third largest psychopathology, which means third largest depression is one of the psychopathologies. Major debilitating forces. Actually, I heard just this morning that was it one in 12 are now into self-harm. Teenagers, where was that in America? Global. One in 12 are now into self-harm. Well, that's got to be, that's epidemic. And and because I believe that there's a whole lot of things that are related to that inner child, which we talked about in the first place, I'm also going to be looking at social anxiety in a very similar way. All right, now I checked out Google and they had about, what was it, 50 to 60 million articles written on social anxiety, so once again it's pretty well known. And I thought I'd go into one of those areas where you have a forum where people write in this, that and the other and try and get help for it. So I just chose one of the 50 odd million sites, and I'd like to read you what one person wrote regarding his anxiety. "Don't give up! Exclamation mark, exclamation mark, exclamation mark. I know what it feels like to feel helpless, but it will get better if you work hard at it. I know that it's easier said than done, but the more you put into it now, the easier it will get, trust me." I don't usually like those two words put at the end, but we'll continue. "I've also had trouble finding a good therapist. I went to 6 different ones before I found someone that I liked. It just takes time and patience. Also, I know what it's like to be bullied and to feel like you're being used. The same thing happened to me all the time. But once you have started some regular counselling, that stuff won't matter to you anymore, and you will learn to be stronger and stand up for yourself more. Have you tried going to support groups in your area or talk to a doctor? They'll be able to help you with medication or give you advice about who to talk to. And someone responded to that particular forum, said, thank you so much for your advice. Everything you've said has helped me, except that when I went to the therapist, I felt judged. She was treating me like a child, and I didn't understand what she was saying, and the truth was, she didn't say very much. As for doing nice things for people, I totally agree, and it makes me feel awesome, but the majority of my life, people have preyed upon that kindness, and the amount of bullying I have been subjected to is unimaginable. My whole life I've been a sort of laughing stock, a way for people to feel better about themselves, and my whole life I have let it happen because I've always been told that I was special. Their best friend forever, and there's no better feeling than feeling like you're important. The only person I can talk to is now dead. So I feel so alone, and you're the only person who has made me feel like I'm not, and I'm belong somewhere, even though it may not be here. By the way, I'm because of some of the typos and things on these forums, I've got to read between the lines here. But that's interesting. I feel so alone, and you're the only person who has made me feel like I'm not, and that I belong somewhere, even though it may not be here. Now, that's frightening when they say that. I thank you so much for that. It really means a lot. And on these forums go. I'll just go to another one for a minute. To another site. And I'd like to read this out. Just to give you an overview of what some of the social anxiety features are. A woman hates to stand in line in the grocery store because she's afraid that everyone is watching her. She knows that it's not really true, but she can't shake the feeling. While she is shopping, she is conscious of the fact that people might be staring at her from the big mirrors on the inside front of the ceiling. Now she has to talk to the person who's checking out her groceries. She tries to smile, but her voice comes out weakly. She's making a fool of herself. Her self-consciousness and anxiety rise to the roof. I'll just pick out one more. A man finds it difficult to walk down the street because he's self-conscious and feels that people are watching him from their windows. Worse, he may run into a person on the sidewalk and be forced to say hello to them. He is not sure he can do that. His voice will catch, his hello will sound weak, and the other person will know he's frightened. More than anything else, he doesn't want anyone to know that he's afraid. He keeps his eyes safely away from anyone else's gaze and prays he can make it home without having to talk to anyone. Now, the reason I read that one out is because for most of my younger life, I was exactly like that. And I can remember one day, it was this going back about 40-odd years, and the shopping centre was on either side of the main road, and I saw a friend coming down the street towards me. And most of the time I would have my watch and my wrist on my chest, looking down at my watch to check the time every now and then, like every 7 seconds or so. And then when I saw this friend coming towards me, I walked over the other side of the road, looked at the shop windows, waited until they'd passed, and then went back over the other side of the road. Now, if you don't know that degree of social anxiety, you are very fortunate. But I knew that if I spoke to that person, I would have nothing to say, that my voice would go funny, that I would spend the next couple of days saying, oh, why did I say that? I should have said this. Oh, that was a stupid thing to say. Oh, he's going to think I'm an idiot. And on and on and on it goes. If you've never experienced it, just remember, it's now becoming the world's third highest psychopathology. All right. And there's a whole lot of people out there exactly like that. Now, so some of the key factors and some of the things that can trigger all of this, I'm going to read a bit of a list here on one of the other sites. Being introduced to other people. You haven't got anything to say, so why would you want to be introduced to anyone else? That's like being thrown into a den of lions, and you're not Daniel. Being teased or criticized. It's just destroying. Now, no one likes to be teased or criticized, okay? But there's a certain healthy level where you can just flick it and go on. Or respond appropriately and address it. But when you're younger, you haven't got those skills, and so every dart, every arrow, every harpoon just goes straight through. Being the center of attention. And by the way, in this checklist, there may be some that you are really don't care about much, but others will really have a massive effect. Okay, so you just got to do a bit of a checklist yourself. And on the 50 million sites, you can get a whole stack of other checklists, but they virtually all say the same. Being the center of attention. No, don't like that. Being watched while you're doing something. I can remember the teacher looking over my shoulder while I was writing, and I would freeze. Just wish I could be, wish I could just go through that crack in the floor. Meeting people in authority, and particularly if you think that they're important people. Now, they may not be, but if you think they're important people, that's when the palms go sweaty, the mouth goes dry, and you just feel, once again, why was I born? This is a terrible situation for me to be in, and so on and so forth. Speaking in a group. Now, that's interesting. If you're in a circle in particular, and everyone has to go around and say something, and it's now your turn, and you have been spending the whole time, what am I going to say? I've got to say something. If I say something stupid, I am going to be exposed to this whole group, and by the way, there is a certain level that this will apply to everybody, okay? None of us want to look a fool, but when it actually becomes a disorder, that's when it's not good. Eating and drinking in public, making small talk at parties, most social occasions, meeting or talking to members of the opposite sex, using the telephone. I know some people who just cannot pick up that phone. It's a frightening, horrible experience. And you think, well, now how does all of this, how did all of this start? You know, because you think, well, the answer is, were we born that way? And the answer to that is, I believe, is primarily no. But if in the womb you have heard the conflict between parents, if in the womb you have been hit and told you're not wanted instead of being talked to lovingly and having mum or dad sing to you in the belly there, which is the appropriate thing to do. But if that hasn't happened and there's been rejection even from the womb, then that person will come out with a feeling that Nah, this is not a good place to live. Remember that the first year of our life, we decide whether or not this is a good place to live. And if we find out it's not, then on Eric Erickson's scale, if we find out this is not a good place to live, the cot may be comfortable, but if all the environment around it is just screaming, yelling, and chaos, we do not find peace in our hearts. If there is a genetic predisposition towards it, and there may be, I believe that environmental factors can are also extremely important. You know, people say that there's two arguments, nurture and nature. Nature, our genetic makeup, the way we were born, our genes from our parents, all that stuff. And nurture, and the nurture, the way our environment, the way we're brought up and so forth. Now, can anyone see that there's actually another component to all of that that almost nobody talks about? There's nurture and nature. Okay. Well, within nurture and nature, sorry? Going a bit higher than that, and it's the God factor. Very, very, I haven't heard anyone say that, well, what about God in the nurturing process and God in the creative nature process? And unless he's brought into it, so there's nurture, nature, and the God factor in all of that, which I believe can outweigh all of the other, and I have seen God work miraculously in people's lives that can turn their lives around. Okay, are you with me? Nurture, nature, and how God is sovereign over all of that. But I'm not sure you may hear that in the university lectures soon. But I believe it's very, very important. Now, here's the word picture I'd like to give you, well, that I believe is a major component in anxiety. Now, I personally believe that if a kid is brought up in a really functional, what can we say, a functional, a very a family where the forces ebb and flow and kids are allowed to express themselves, and the love is just showing right, left and center, then those kids will have very, very strong foundations in their life and may not know anything that I'm talking about in this YouTube presentation, okay? However, if their foundations have been cracked and flawed, then they just may have an understanding. I've just been trying to think of a word, but it'll come later. If they're brought up in an adaptive, functional family, and the word is adaptive as opposed to maladaptive. Okay. If, however, they've been brought up in a war zone, and this is the best way I can explain it to clients, and a way that nearly every client can understand. If you're brought up in a war zone, then then in World War I, it would be said that you suffered from shell-shocked. World War I, they called it shell-shocked. World War II, they called it war neuroses. And that's kind of when your best friend was blown up beside you in those wars. But shell-shocked, war neuroses. We now have a much more sophisticated name for it called post-traumatic stress disorder. However, what we're finding is that even guys coming back from war zones, even in a peacekeeping situation, they're suffering more from prolonged duress stress disorder, PD, PTSD, okay? Prolonged duress stress disorder. We're having been in that situation for 9 months of being on the edge, being vigilant to the point of being hypervigilant all that time, because you never know when the snipers are going to get you. Then being in that environment for so long causes prolonged duress stress disorder. Now, you don't have to go into a war zone anywhere in this world to be in a war zone. You can actually have a war zone in suburbia. You can have a war zone under your roof. You can have a war zone in which a kid's walking along and stands on a landmine that they didn't even know was there. But as they're walking around, it just blows up. And that kid's left shell-shocked, wondering, what did I do wrong? What happened? Why did the parents or this one or that one explode when I do that? And there seems to be no explanation for the kid. But that kid has now entered into a war zone. And it may be that as they're walking up the hallway, I'm just thinking of a case right now, that a hand grenade, verbally speaking, was thrown at them. And I can remember one kid that was just attacked in the hallway by this person, and this poor kid just kind of withered and melted and slid down the wall because of what the parent was yelling and screaming at them. So does that turn that kid's life into a war zone? You better believe it. It's not the love, joy, and peace that the Lord wanted, but it's now a war zone. They can have sniper attacks and get shot at right, left, and center, and still not knowing, their lives become in danger of these giant geniuses called adults. Or if they go into a schoolyard, and we read one case there where they were being bullied, well, all of a sudden the school is now a war zone, and those kids' lives are in danger with cyberbullying, texting, and all the rest of that. A kid's life can get attacked even in the privacy of their home, even if their home is now a haven from the storms of life, which it should be. They can still get attacked on their mobile phone with these Facebook entries and so forth, tweets and so forth, text messages. And so their life is once again put into a war zone. And I'm sure you can think of a whole lot of areas where, as we grow up, our lives are put into a war zone. Now, I know I'm harping on it a bit, but I want to get that concept over, because number one, in that area, love, emotional, vitamin pills, which I talked about in the inner child, that inner child doesn't get those love, emotional, vitamin pills, and so it will not grow up. Being in a war zone stops a kid's spiritual and emotional growth. And so, what happens is they learn to recognize when they're in the presence of the enemy. Now, I think this is kind of the punchline here. They learn to recognize when they're in the presence of the enemy. How do you know what the enemy looked like with all that training, right from being a toddler, right through being bullied at school? How do you know what the enemy really looked like? Well, I'm going to tell you. They've got one head, one body, and usually two arms and two legs, unless there's been amputations or some physical or genetic problems there. Okay? But they have, in other words, any human being on this planet can now be the enemy. And the enemy that puts their lives in danger. So when they go out to talk in front of people, usually they can either switch off to the individual and just do it very well, like an actor, or they can go out there and freeze, knowing that every one of these people in front of them are really the Gestapo, the enemy, that are judging them, that could have the potential to criticize them, to bring their life low. And so what they think, the audience may think about what they're doing, makes the audience the enemy. Or perhaps you just are walking through some of the shopping centers around, and in a shopping center you are just surrounded by enemies. They're everywhere, whether they be the checkout chick, whether they be just people milling around. You are in the middle of enemy territory. And so fear, anxieties arise, and all kinds of panic attacks and agoraphobia, whole range of disorders can surface. And I see that as being primarily because in at least one part in their life, they were in a major war zone that gave them the impression that people are out to get them. People are out to judge them, criticize them, and bring them down. Once that happens, it takes a lot of counseling to reverse it. One of the major therapies that are recommended is cognitive behavioral therapy, and there's a whole lot of exercises, for example, panic attacks, to do breathing exercises. Some people have gone to quite a great deal of research, worked out that on different days you can actually breathe at different rates, and particularly at different times in different dates, different days you can have different breath rates. And so, but usually just slowing your breath down to one, two, intake, one, two, is pretty good. And that can allay some of the fear and anxieties. However, the way I've been talking about right through this series is that there are rooms in your heart. And there's a room in your heart with female biological parent on the door. There's a room in your heart with male biological parent on the door. There's a room in your heart with school bullies on the door. There's a room in your heart with boyfriend, girlfriend, breakup, disaster in your heart. There's a room in your heart where some tragedy occurred. I heard that the gentleman who wrote Peter Pan, experienced his brother being killed in an accident on the street in front of him, and James Barry being killed in a accident right there in front of him. And here goes, this is the kind of trauma that turned James Barry's world into what I believe was a nightmare, and if we can go a little bit further, into a war zone. Now, check this one out. Because he wrote Peter Pan, and I'm sure you've all read the stories, even to your kids and so forth. But after seeing his brother killed in the accident, and Mum loved the brother, but didn't particularly like James. In fact, I don't, from what I've heard, didn't like him at all. And what would happen is, after the death of the sibling, James, in trying to earn Mum's love, would make breakfast for her in the morning, would knock on the door, and Mum would say, "Come in," thinking that it was the dead brother come back, or that it was the dead brother at the door. When James came in, she would say something like, "Oh, it's only you." And that, therefore, James, who wrote Peter Pan, lived in a war zone. And I believe the inner child within him died at a very young age. And because it was no longer able to get love emotional vitamin pills, Peter Pan, I believe, was a very real representation of James Barry. And he could relate to someone never growing up, because his spirit and soul, I believe, didn't grow up. Because day after day, "Oh, it's only you." Do you know what, how damaging that would be to a kid, day after day after day? Where's the love emotional vitamin pills in that? I can't see any. And so he was able to write, I believe, out of his own experience, Peter Pan, the boy that never grew up. When he died, they had to have an autopsy because of, discern the reason for death. And would you believe that the report I've heard is that he never reached puberty. Never reached puberty. How they discerned that, I'm not sure, but that's the way they checked him out, and that hadn't happened. So when I talk about the inner child, when I talk about being in a war zone, they're examples of one James Barry being in that regard. Very, very sad. Very sad. Behavioral cognitive therapy, as I read, some person had to search through six therapists before they came to someone who understand. And if a therapist says, "Look, what you've got to do is face your fears and so forth," I really think that they don't understand that much, because that person would have been trying to face his fears or her fears all their life with zero or minimal success. I believe it's only when the rooms of the heart are cleaned out, the Lord shows someone what's in that room, what needs to be cleared out, and getting the Lord into that room, the Lord Jesus Christ into that room, that finally that person can be released from those anxieties and be set free. I don't walk around with my watch on my chest anymore. And to do this once upon a time would have sent me into incredible anxiety. Okay. I'm sure when I close this off, I'll think of a lot of things I should have said. But any questions just off the top of your heads there? Okay. It is debilitating. And from that, you often find obsessive compulsive disorders coming from it, a whole range of behavioral problems, in cognitive behavioral therapy, cognitive is things of the mind, reprogramming the mind to think no, that doesn't apply anymore, situations have changed. And I remember one person that the way through was to let this person know, no, that's not your parent. Because every time they met guys, for example, fear and everything would come up, and she had to keep telling herself, no, that's not my father. Others would say, no, that's not my mother, but not my father. And try and work their way through it, saying, no, I shouldn't project on these people something that one person did to me back then. I should not project onto innocent people things that someone who has damaged my life did back when I was 10 or so. Because that is actually unfair to the people you are judging. And so we worked our way through all of that. But the best way is to ask the Lord Jesus Christ to show what's in that room, what needs to be given to him, so he can go in there and remove it. And I believe we've had some incredible success when the Lord Jesus does the counseling and I step aside and let him.